takes just to see you, to behold you as my king. I wanna be where you are. Peace is where you are. Joy is where you are. And love is who you are. Woo! Wanna be where you are. Somebody make that your prayer in this moment. Gotta be where you are. Everything I need is where.
Anticipating a move of God, a move of God. I'm expecting, anticipating a move of God, a move of God.
Anybody expect it tonight? Come on, if you're expecting, can you lift up those hands and say,
I'm expecting, anticipating.
Come on, somebody sing that with me. Say,
I'm expecting, anticipating.
If you feel like I feel tonight, you said it. Say, we won't be satisfied.
We can see this very thing happen while we're still in the earth, in our nation. We're gonna see.
We've been praying for it.
We've been longing for it.
We're gonna see a move of God.
I know you've been praying.
You've been longing for it.
And I declare to you that it's coming to the earth in this generation.
Yeah.
Let's stand in this house tonight. Somebody with a praise on your lips and in your heart. Why don't we lift it up to the King of Kings right now? Come on, put those hands together. Somebody lift that voice and give God a praise. Like you know He's worthy. Like you know He deserves it. Come on, we've come to bless the King of Kings in this house. song. This isn't just a song that we sang on a Tuesday night. This isn't just some fun lyric that we put together. When you speak the name, chains are broken. When you speak the name, miracles happen. When you speak the name, the very atmosphere must change. When you speak the name of Jesus, somebody do it right now. Somebody speak the name of Jesus over your family. Somebody speak the name of Jesus over your house. Somebody speak the name of Jesus. Demons tremble at the name. Blind eyes are open at the name. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Somebody lift it up in this house right now. Come on, we're going to go ahead and have prayer right now. Whatever you need can be taken care of right here. Whatever sickness you have in your body can be healed right now in the name of Jesus. Somebody lift those hands. God, we're believing if you did it before, that you're still able to do it. If you can't do it, Lord, then it can't be done. Right now, we plead the blood of Jesus over every life in this house, over every disease, over every sickness. We bind it in the name of Jesus, and we lose healing. We lose faith. Somebody ought to believe that right now. Somebody ought to believe that. At the mention of the name of Jesus. Somebody put those hands together like it's already done. Oh, come on, exercise a little faith in this house and put those hands together. Woo! Hallelujah. It feels good in the house tonight. I said it feels good in the house tonight. There's a lot of places I could be, a lot of places I should be, but thank God I'm in the house. Thank God I'm in his house tonight. Thank you, Jesus. We want to keep Travis and Ashley in prayer. God knows every need in this house. Amen. God knows every need. We already went before the Lord, so we're not going to go again, but keep them in your prayers. God knows every need, knows every situation. Amen. Let's go and head back to our seats. We're going to jump into the Tuesday night announcements. Hallelujah. Looking forward to what God's going to do in this house tonight. Amen. How many of you come expecting God to do something? Come on, if you didn't expect God to do something in this house, you should have just stayed home. If you didn't come into this house with expectation of the miraculous, with expectation to receive a word, then you came in vain tonight. I'm expecting God to move in this house. Amen, amen. Let's go ahead and jump into the announcements. Early morning prayer, 6 a.m. Monday through Friday, right here at the Rock Church. Family prayers every Thursday night at 7 p.m. Amen. Tonight, look at your neighbor and say, tonight. Tonight is the last chance that you have to purchase chocolate-covered strawberries. You know what we should have done was we should have done a taste testing. So I think some people are sleeping on the chocolate-covered strawberries. If you want to be blessed, go ahead and purchase some chocolate-covered strawberries. All orders will be ready this Sunday immediately following morning service. Do not miss out on this delicious treat. Thank you to everyone already who has supported and helped Rock Christian Academy. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Abundant Life class will be postponed. Look at your neighbor and say postponed until next week. Street ministry every Friday and Saturday night at 7 p.m. Amen. Kids Zone and Heat will be meeting this Friday night at 7 p.m. Outreach will be meeting Saturday at 1 p.m. Amen. Casting the Net Bible Study. Casting the Net Bible Study. Amen. Is Saturday at 11 a.m. Location will be at the Ramirez Residence. To sign up, please see Brother and Sister or Sister Ramirez.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I'm up here just to give a really quick announcement to something that is going to be amazing, something that we've all been waiting for, something that everybody can take part of. I'm here to announce that this year for Resurrection Sunday, we will have our very first TRC Resurrection Drama. Yes, yes. And right now, this is a casting call, right? If you are interested in acting, if you're interested in being an extra, if you're interested in just building something, if you have an eye for art, if you have an eye for decorations, anything, we need you. So Sister Morgan and I, we are actually taking names and information for auditions. Let me tell you something. We were there last night and we had like a little powwow. We were meeting about the script, and the script is almost done. And when I tell you that God is just working this thing out, He's working it out. We have some anointed writers, some creative writers. We have writers of all kinds. And listen, you don't want to sleep on this one. If you want to be involved, come see us. We have 9 weeks to get this done, and I believe we can in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. So Women's Life Ministry will be putting on a Worth the Wait couple speak event. Amen? So, you know, this is the month of February, and there is a lot of love in the air. So, you know, there are a lot of people who are like, what's the wait? What's worth the wait? All right, so in one hand, let me give you a little demonstration. I have chocolate peanut M&Ms. These are my favorite. In the other hand, I have Hershey's milk chocolate. If you want it, come get it. All right. Okay, so what Brother Spilazza doesn't know is that although this eye candy looks good, inside of it, it's all broken up, smashed, and smeared. Who has the M&Ms? What Sister Wanda Lee doesn't know, give her a hand clap. They really tried hard. I didn't expect that. But what she doesn't know is that although that eye candy looks so good on the outside, and the inside it's crushed up and messed up and broken. And you know, sometimes that's what we do when we are considering someone to date or to marry. It's just eye candy on the outside. And on the inside it's all crushed up and broken. So I'm going to tell you it's worth the wait, amen? There's a lot of you that sat out there and looked at that candy like, nah, I'm good. So Saturday, tell your neighbor, Saturday, February 19th, 5 p.m. here at the Rock Church, we have dynamic couples that are going to give us insight on dating and courting and doing it the apostolic biblical way. And to give you one little sneak peek, one of the couples will be our very own brother and sister, Pat. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You're going to want to be there. And you're going to love this. I just got permission to open it up to the men as well. Yes. So if you are 18 and older, male or female, you are welcome to this event. We're going to have some light refreshments. If you are under the age of 18 and would like to come, please speak to your HEAT and or college and career directors, and they'll be able to guide you on that. Amen. So meet us out here February 19th at 5:30 p.m.
Let's keep putting those hands together for all our guests and visitors in the house. Come on, let's give them a nice Rock Church warm welcome. For those of you streaming online, we're excited that you joined us. Now, let's take a few moments, step out of our seat, read across the aisle, greet someone in the name of Jesus.
Thank you. He's been better than good to you. Somebody give him a shout of praise right now. As a matter of fact, the Bible said to praise him according to his excellent greatness. So if he's been better than good to you, throw your voice in the air and give God a shout of praise in this house. Come on, shout like he's been good to you. Shout like he's been good to you. Yay! Hallelujah, hallelujah. Woo! High five three or four people standing next to you. Tell them he's been good to me. He's been good to me. Amen. Remain standing for just a few moments. We want the ushers to come. We are preparing tonight to bring the Lord's tithing and our offering into the house of the Lord. Amen. I'm bringing my tithe and offering into the house of the Lord because he's been better than good to me. I said I'm bringing it because he's been better than good to me. Amen. It is so good to be home tonight. Woo! With the greatest people on the planet Earth. My God, I love y'all right back. I love you right back. And I'm so thankful for the incredible reports that concerning this past weekend and everything that the Lord did in this building. And I was with you in heart and in mind. And I was so excited about what the Lord did in our all-in offering on Sunday. Is anybody just beaming with excitement about the future and the vision of this house? I don't have the final numbers with me at the moment, but I know we are well north, somewhere around 150,000 for the year. I don't remember, something like that, in pledges for this year. I think we ought to give God a praise for that. And I want to take a moment because if you were not here Sunday, or perhaps you were here and just did not get the opportunity to turn in your pledge for all in, just raise your hand really quick because I see a couple of hands going up. The ushers are ready. Just keep your hand up. The ushers have an all in pledge card and a pen, and you can do that tonight. You can turn this right into the offering tonight. And of course, there's a place on the card for your name, for the annual amount that you are pledging, and then the monthly pledge is just the annual amount divided by 12. And then, of course, Sunday we also begin to receive February's pledges for all in. And so if you were not able to give your pledge on Sunday, you can give that tonight as well. We just want to make sure that you indicate your all-in offering. If you're using a tithing envelope, which is what we encourage everybody to do, tithe and offering envelope. There's a spider right there. In Jesus' name, amen. I mean, I couldn't just act like he wasn't there. I mean, I just... Y'all would have thought I was getting the... He's feeling that announcement right there. Where was I? Oh, turning in your pledge. So if you haven't, make sure you get a tithing and offering envelope. And for right now, there's a spot on there that says other. You can just write in there all in with the amount you're giving for the all in offering. Our new envelope should be in soon, which will have a place there specifically for all in offering. Amen. But I am so excited about what the Lord is doing in this place. I'm telling you, amen. Incredible, incredible things unfolding. And so if you've got the Lord's tithing, your offering, why don't you lift it in the air as high as you can get it tonight. Let's pray together. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the privilege and the honor of being in your house today. Lord, we stand before you under the auspices of your blessings and your promises and the unfailing words that you have given us in your word. God, we bring our tithing and offering to you tonight, God, as a sign of our faith in you. Lord, we are grateful that your hand is upon us and that we are in covenant relationship with you. We know that your word declares that when we bring our tithe and offering unto you, that you will open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that there shall not be room to receive it. And so, Lord, we want to wave this tithing and offering before you tonight, God, as a sign of our faith in your promises and your word. Bless the giver tonight, God. Bless those that are faithful to your house, faithful in their time and their talent and their treasure. We give you the praise and the glory and all of the honor. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Somebody ought to give God a great shout of praise, and you ought to dance your way to the front of this house as you bring the Lord's tithing and your offering into this place tonight.
Walking in victory tonight. Amen. Amen. Grab your Bibles. I want to hasten to the word of the Lord in this house tonight. Let me add to what has already been said in giving a great big welcome tonight to all of our guests that are here in the house of the Lord with us. One more time, Rock Church, can I borrow your hands and your voice and help me make some noise for all of our guests that are here in the building with us tonight? Amen. We are so excited that you are here. To all those that are streaming online with us tonight, we're glad that you were able to tune in to what God is doing in this place. I want to say what a privilege it is to have our dear friend, Sister Amanda Collins, with us tonight. All the way from Burlington, North Carolina. And she brought her sidekicks with her, Sister Kiara. And Sister Lexi, is that right? Did I get it right? Sierra, I'm sorry. Well, it depends on what country you're from, how you would say it. So I'm being fancy with it. But we're so glad that they're here. And Sister Collins came to put her artistic touch on a few things around here. And so she's going to be hanging out for the next few weeks, getting some work done around here. But I'm excited they're here tonight. Amen. Amen. Did anybody come expecting something great in your spirit tonight? Did you come ready to have church tonight? I mean, did you come ready to have church tonight? Amen. If you promise to preach with me, I'm going to do my best to be expeditious tonight and be as efficient as possible. Without jeopardizing what I feel like God wants me to say tonight. The book of Numbers chapter 13 is where I want to invite you to read the word of the Lord with me tonight. So many things in my spirit, on my heart, in my mind. And as I was navigating them all, trying my best to be obedient to what the Lord wanted to do in this house tonight, I could not escape this word tonight, and really, I feel like God said, I want you to remind my people about this. And so that's precisely what I intend to do tonight. Amen. The book of Numbers, chapter 13, and verse number 23. Says, and they came unto the brook of Eshcol and cut down from thence a branch with one cluster of grapes, and they bare it between two upon a staff, and they brought the pomegranates and of the figs. One transliteration renders verse 23 like this: when they came to the valley of Eshcol, they cut down a branch with a single cluster of grapes so large that it took two of them to carry it on a pole between them. skipping down to verse number 32. Same chapter, same story. These men are literally holding on to a pole with a cluster of grapes so big that you would not say, "Do you want some of my grapes?" You would say, "Do you want a bite of my grape?" And while they are holding this in their hands, verse 32 picks up and says, "They brought up an evil report of the land which they had searched unto the children of Israel, saying, 'The land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. And all the people that we saw in it are men of a great stature. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight.'" One transliteration renders 32 and 33 like this: "So they spread this bad report about the land amongst the Israelites. 'The land we traveled through and explored will devour anyone who goes to live there. All the people we saw were huge. We even saw giants there, the descendants of Anak, and next to them, we felt like grasshoppers.'" And that's what they thought too. And for a few moments, I just want to preach: grasshoppers don't eat grapes. Turn around and tell at least two or three people standing next to you: grasshoppers don't eat grapes. Now I wish you would put those hands together one more time and mix your faith with the word of the Lord in this place tonight. I came to remind this house tonight that grasshoppers don't eat grapes. I need somebody on a Tuesday night to make some noise up in this place tonight. I need somebody on a Tuesday night that's already got this in your spirit to just give God a... Woo. I'm not a grasshopper, but I know how to jump. I'm not a grasshopper, but I know how to fly. If you promise to keep shouting like that, you can be seated. If not, just start running the aisles while I preach in Jesus' name. Many years ago, when the legendary Newt Rockne was the coach at Notre Dame, the Fighting Irish were facing a critical football game against a vastly superior Southern California team. And during the week before the game, Rockne had a great idea. He recruited every big and brawny student in the entire student body to suit up for this particular game, but not to play, just to run out onto the field with the team and to sit on the bench. On the day of the game, Southern Cal came out on the field first. Then, at the very last minute, here came Notre Dame. 150 huge players came rumbling onto the field. The Southern Cal team stopped in their tracks and just stared at this assembly of green giants. Newt Rockne had psyched them out. And though the USC coach told his team that only 11 men could play at a time, the damage had been done. USC lost, not because Notre Dame was better, but because Southern Cal had been intimidated. Can I preach to somebody in this place this evening that most, if not all, of our limitations in life are self-imposed? If you were to sit back and examine every time that we declare that I can't, that I'm not able to, that I just don't have what it takes, it is the sum result of self-imposed limitations that we placed on ourselves. Can I preach to you that we serve a God that has no limitations? I'm going to need a few people in the building. We serve a God that said with men, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. As a matter of fact, in one place, the Lord declares that if they have faith as a grain of mustard seed, I just need some Bible students in the building. If they have faith as a grain of mustard seed, he said, there shall be nothing. Somebody shout nothing that is impossible unto them. I came to declare unto this church that for where God is taking us and for the doors that we're walking through this year, we need a fresh reminder tonight that grasshoppers don't eat grapes, that we're a people of impossibility, that we're a people of big things, that we're a people of an unlimited God. We're the people of a God that specializes in things that are impossible. So I dare you right now at the beginning of this service to lift your hands and lift your voice and begin to declare right now, God is able. God, as a matter of fact, he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all, above all that we can ask or that we can think. God can do bigger than you can dream. God can do bigger than what you could possibly pray. God can do bigger than you can possibly imagine. Sometimes you gotta throw away your pen and paper and understand God can do the impossible. Charles F. Kettering, who at one time was the head of engineering for a major motor company, said that one of his greatest challenges when he would have a staff meeting and he would meet with all of these engineers and all of these designers, he would oftentimes put a sign on the door that led to the meeting room that said, leave your rulers and calculators at the door. He said, because invariably I would be in a meeting casting vision, and what they would begin to do is try and put it on paper. They were trying to calculate it and trying to figure it out. And invariably there would be somebody that would stand up and say, sir, that's not possible. Sir, I've calculated. He said, so I came to understand that if we're ever going to break barriers, if we're ever going to break through the glass ceiling, then we've got to throw away our mechanisms of restraint. We've got to cast off every tool of constraint and let our hearts and our minds begin to. That's what I feel like tonight. As we walk into the open door and into the year of the potential that God has, I came to remind this church, it's time to cast off every preconception of how anything has been done before. I don't care if you've never seen it before. I don't care if you've never witnessed it before. God is about to do the impossible in this. I just need 30 people that are excited about that tonight. I don't care if you've never seen it on this wise. Baby, there's always a first time for everything. And why not let it be us, God? Why not let it be the Rock Church, God? Do I got anybody in the building that knows what I'm talking about? Grasshoppers don't eat grapes. Woo! Unlimited potential, unlimited possibilities, unlimited blessing, unlimited favor. Korabashat, I'm going to preach until every spirit of unbelief has to back up out of here. I'm going to preach until some of you serve an eviction notice to fear that's got its hands around your neck tonight. I'm going to preach this tonight until somebody shakes loose of the chains of limitation that want to hold you in place. I came to declare unto you that grasshoppers don't eat grapes. Woo. In a recent poll taken by Americans in their 20s, this question was asked: what is the basic feeling you have about life? 60% said fear. Most people define themselves either by their problems or their possibilities. Fearful people wake up each morning and locate themselves on a problem chart. But people of faith should wake up and consult their possibility chart. You got to have a predisposition every day that you wake up that casts fear and unbelief out of your spirit. I need some help in this building. How many of you remember the first things cast into the lake of fire is fear and unbelief? And if it's going to be cast into the fire, you ought to learn how to cast it out of your mind. You ought to learn how to cast it out of your... Oh, I'm preaching to somebody right now. Fear is not going to leave willingly. Unbelief is not going to vacate on its own premonition. If you're going to get it out of your life, you've got to cast it out of your... Not get it out, cast it out. That's a whole different pill. I need about 8 guys. Quick. Get right here. Just run. 4 and 4. 4. Face each other in the line. 4 and 4. Yeah, face each other. Get your arms connected together across from each other. Connect your hands and arms. No, to the person across from you. To the person across from you. To the person. There you go. Get them tight. But spread apart just a little bit. Spread apart just a little bit in between yourselves. Yeah. Hold it nice tight. Get as tight as you can together this way. Come on. Y'all grab your cameras. It's Instagrammable stuff in church. Come on, get tight. Come this way. Hey, y'all, get tight up against each other, shoulder to shoulder. Tight, tight. Now spread it out a little bit. Spread out. Now back your head. Lean your head back. Hold your arms tight. Don't you dare let go. Fear and unbelief. Come here, fear. Come here, unbelief. Hurry. Some of us have become too comfortable living every day with fear and unbelief as our companions. We become too comfortable waking up every day, our minds bombarded by the fear of what if it doesn't work? What if I fail? What if I get sick? What if I lose my job? What if I don't have... And our day is filled with the thoughts of fear and unbelief. Can I tell you, they're never going to go... But on their own, would you please leave? They're never going to leave. Would you please go? They're going to fold their arms and double down. Please, I'm tired of feeling this way. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I'm tired of waking up every day wondering what's happening. I'm tired of waking up. No. If you're going to get fear and unbelief out of your life, fear and unbelief is standing on your vision. It is choking out your dreams. It's standing on your faith. If you're going to get fear and unbelief, you've got to cast it out. You got to grab it by the back of its neck, and it's going to kick and scream. It doesn't want to go. And you're going to say, listen here, pal. Yeah, you're going. I said you're going to. You're going. Take it easy. Listen. That's exactly what it's like. It can't be theater either, because it's made up in its mind. But you got to make up in your mind, I'm not living under fear any longer. And you got to cast it out of your spirit. Hurry, reset. You got to cast unbelief. Get out of my life. And then you've got to defend the door. You ain't coming back. Come here. And when it tries to get back up, when it tries to, you got, no, get back. No. Do you see what I just did to unbelief? Your next fear. You gotta make up in your mind. I'm not living in fear. I'm not a grasshopper. Everything isn't bigger than I am. I'm the head and I'm not the tail. I'm above and I'm not beneath. I'm the lender and I'm not the borrower. Grasshoppers, don't eat grapes. I need somebody that believes that tonight to give God a shout of praise. On a Tuesday night, somebody needs to take dominion. On a Tuesday. My God, I've got the Holy Ghost. Acts says, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. There's two words for power in the Bible, exousia and dunamis. Exousia is authority. It's the badge on the police officer. He has power. It's delegated authority. But in case you don't recognize exousia, he has a piece strapped on his side. And that is dunamis, where we get the word dynamite. If you don't understand exousia, I've got some dunamis that I'll introduce you to. When it says you shall receive power, it's the word dunamis. You gotta walk around saying, devil, I got something for you. Devil, I'm packing right now. I got you. You ought to roll up on the enemy in your life and let him know, I've been waiting for you, and I got something for you. I got power. I'm not afraid of anything. I'm not afraid of any opportunity. I'm not afraid of any situation. Come on, somebody. Grasshoppers, don't eat grapes. Tell your neighbor, I'm not a grasshopper. I know I look funny, but I'm not a grasshopper. I know I walk a little strange, but I'm not a grasshopper. I know you might think I'm not a grasshopper. It reminds me of a story of these two hillbillies. We're friends, and one of them walked into a little local store one day, and he saw a poster that was posted on the bulletin board. They had been having a problem with coyotes in the area. And so, Brother Stewart, they posted a sign that said, reward given. $50 per coyote. They put a bounty. And so this hillbilly said, here's our chance. And he went and told his friend, he said, hey, Bubba. He said, guess what? He said, they're giving $50 per coyote. So they grabbed their guns and they went out into the woods and they decided they were going to camp out that night and they were going to be ready for them coyotes. They fell asleep next to the fire, and in the middle of the night, Bubba woke up. And as his eyes fluttered open, he looked and he saw little yellow eyes peeking out from just on the edge of the bonfire. And he looked and there were little eyes surrounding them. The coyotes, a whole pack of coyotes had show up. Real quietly, he leaned over and said, hey, Jimmy, psh, wake up. Jimmy said, what is it, Bubba? He said, Jimmy, look, there's coyotes all around us. We're in trouble. Jimmy looked around and he said, Bubba, we're not in trouble. We're rich. People who are dominated by faith, you don't wake up looking for the problem. You wake up looking for the opportunity. Oh, I wish I had somebody in the building that understood you're not a victim of life circumstances. You're not a victim of a dilemma. You either believe God's word or you don't. We know. Tell your neighbor, we know that all things work together for the good. I know it looks bad, but baby, it's working for my good. I know the situation's not ideal, but when it's all said and done, it's working for my good. Your impossibility is simply God's opportunity. If you're not careful, you'll become motivated by fear instead of faith. And you've got to control the gateway of your thinking. Tell your neighbor, it starts in the mind. It starts in the mind. Like one preacher used to say, you got to get a checkup from the neck up to get rid of your stinking thinking. You got to defeat the devil right here first. Give me some Bible for that. I'm glad you asked. Proverbs chapter 23 and verse number 7 says, for as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And in another place, the Bible says that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so the whole process, that's why you've got to watch your thoughts, because they become your words. And you've got to watch your words because they become your actions. And you got to watch your actions because they become your habits. And you've got to watch your habits because they become your character. And you've got to watch your character because your character becomes your destiny. You've got to guard your thought life. I cannot think about that kind of mess. Who am I preaching to right now? You got to get it in your spirit to quit sitting around all day letting your thoughts run wild about the potentials of danger and problems and issues. And there's no wonder you're feeling depressed. There's no wonder you've got anxiety. There's no wonder you're running around full of depression and fear. It's because of what you've been entertaining in your mind. You've got to do what the word of the Lord says and bring into captivity. Bring into captivity every thought under the obedience of Christ. Quit letting your thoughts run wild. Put them in captivity. Put those dogs in a cage. You're not running around loose in my life. And so, that was my introduction. Now I'm at the text. They became fixated on the problems and the obstacles. And they let it define their understanding and their context of who they were. They became so fixated. It's a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof. Oh. And there's giants. And all the people that are in the land are big people. They got so focused on the obstacles that it literally began to redefine their own self-identity. And if you're not careful, you can become so wrapped up in fear and unbelief and anxiety, it will literally begin to redefine who you are. I don't care what other people say about you. Well, they said this about me. They said, who cares? But I'm afraid they're going to make other people think this way about me. Who cares? You can't be the thought police. Since when can you run around regulating everybody's mind? That's too big of a job for you. You're going to die of a heart attack and anxiety. I don't care what anybody says about you. I only care about what you say about you. I ain't worried about what anybody else said about you. What I want to know, what do you say about you? Have you allowed all of the stuff to change your perception of who? We must be grasshoppers. We're grasshoppers. It's so big and it's so tough and it's so challenging. This kind of thinking caused them to stumble at the promise of God. They are literally standing in the doorway of the promised land. Literally standing on the precipice of miracle signs and wonders. And they allowed a grasshopper mentality to stop them from ever experiencing what God has prepared for them. I'm preaching to some people in this building. If you're not careful, you'll let fear and unbelief and anxiety and all this stuff, it will literally stop you at the threshold. You could be standing at the precipice of the year of the open door and never walk through the door because of a grasshopper mentality. It's too much. I don't have enough education. I don't have the right background. I made too many mistakes. I don't have the right last name. I ain't got the right skin color. I don't have the list. As long as you'll make the excuse, the enemy will keep feeding them to you. You've got to make up in your mind, I am not a grasshopper. I am a child of God. I'm preaching to some people that got some big dreams in this house. I'm preaching to some people that got big vision in this place. Who are you? Where are you at tonight? I'm preaching to my dreamers in the building tonight. I'm preaching to my visionaries in the building tonight. I'm preaching to you tonight. My God, you're standing on the threshold of every promise that God ever declared over your life. You better make it up in your mind tonight. I am not a grasshopper. Grasshoppers don't eat grapes. God became frustrated with them. In Numbers chapter 14, verse 11, listen to the conversation that he has with Moses. And the Lord said unto Moses, how long will this people provoke me? That's the terminology that he used. Later on in scripture, he would literally refer back to this moment as the day of provocation. God said, you want to know what gets me mad more than anything? Is people who don't have a proper perspective of who they are. said, how long? They were trying God's patience. God said, I've been working with this as long as I can. But how much longer will this people provoke me? And how long, listen, how long will it be ere they believe me? How long is it going to take before they finally start walking in faith? There's some of us, God's wondering that about you. You're wandering around in a wilderness and God's saying, my God, I've got a whole promised land waiting for them. How long are they going to run around with this mentality? How long are they going to run around before they actually start believing that my word is true? How long before they start living in fear over faith? Faith over fear. Listen. He said, how long will it be ere they believe me? Listen, for all the signs which I have showed among them. What got God really angry is he said, look at them. They're complaining at the same time that they got their hands on the promise. While they are complaining and full of fear, they're holding on to signs of my miracles. Sitting here delivered from the sin that had you bound and yet still complaining that God's not able to do what he promised. Holding on to grapes, but thinking like a grasshopper. Holding on to the evidence. The grapes were evidence of his promise. On one hand, they walked in and said, my God, look at these grapes. And in the same breath are talking about the land too big for them and the people too great for them. Holding the evidence and complaining at the same time. There is a prevailing spirit that tries its best to keep God's people thinking that we are grasshoppers in the land of promise. I know God said we could do it. I know he said we could have it. But I know God said that this building isn't big enough and we're going to have to buy a bigger one. But it's so hard. Look at how big it is. I know God is challenging me in the all-in offering. But look at my situation, God. Look at my situation. God's saying, my God, you got grapes in your hand and you're acting like a grasshopper. Remember the term all-in comes from the game of unlimited poker. And when somebody says, I'm all in, they take every one of their chips, all of them, and they push them into the middle, and they say, I'm all in. What it means is that they feel like they have been dealt a hand that is so incredible they cannot lose. I'm here to tell you this morning, you're holding on to a hand that is a testimony. You serve a God that said you cannot lose. I just need about 20 radical people that believe Psalm 1. Whatsoever he doeth, where you at tonight? When you got that kind of card in your hand, you don't worry about the rest of it. You just walk out and say, I'm all in. What do you mean you're all in? I'm holding on to a hand that cannot be beat. Whatsoever he doeth shall. I got three people that got it tonight. Oh, yeah. Oh, wait a second. I got a card that says that no weapon formed against me shall be able to prosper. So it doesn't matter what comes against me. I'm still going to win. I'm all in. Count me in.
Where's the land? Where's the promise? Where's the vineyards? Well, I need about 20 people in the building that understand grasshoppers don't eat grapes. Come on, in other words, look what's in your hand. Look what God placed in your hand. You've got too much evidence in your hand to be acting like a grasshopper. You've got too many promises in your hand to be working in unbelief. You've got too many miracles that God has done for you to be walking around with a grasshopper mentality. Come on, somebody. A grasshopper mentality is a mentality that has an aversion to big things because of its self-perception of its small size. The problem is that you'll have an aversion to big God things. And so even when God says, look at this big thing I've got for you, your mentality will say, no, you got the wrong person, God. It couldn't be for me. Come on, I'm preaching to somebody right now. That's the difference. Can I preach to us as a church? That's the difference between churches that walk in blessing and promise and churches that stay kind of just in their own little thing. The churches that walk into big things get the revelation. We're not a grasshopper church. We're not some little church on the corner. We're not some backwoods little people who are some weirdos in society. Baby, I'm a king's kid. I've got royalty in my vein. My daddy owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He sits high and he looks low. The heavens are his throne and the earth is his footstool. Baby, that's how I'm walking into this year. I'm believing God for big things. I just need about 100 people that are believing God for big things this year. Dare you to jump out of your seat and run to this altar and throw your hands in the air and start declaring the big things. I'm declaring big blessings. I'm declaring big promotion. I'm declaring big blessings, big promises. Come on, I dare you. Don't you dare sit there like a grasshopper with your mouth closed. Don't you dare sit there like a grasshopper, afraid to move, afraid to worship. I believe it so much that I'm going to praise him in advance for what I see. I believe it so much that I'm going to dance in advance for what I know God is bringing. I dare somebody right now to take about 60 seconds and just dance over what God has shown you. Dance over the promises. Dance over your dreams. Dance over your vision. Dance over what God said belonged to you. Come on, somebody. I came to declare to every devil in hell that grasshoppers don't eat grapes. I'm not a grasshopper. I'm a child of the King. Come on, somebody, right now, right now. I feel like preaching, but I feel something breaking loose in this house right now. I want to finish the sermon, but I feel faith beginning to stir in this building right now. Come on, I need somebody to tap in. I need somebody to tap in right now. Somebody's casting out fear right now. Somebody is casting out unbelief right now. Somebody is casting out doubt and vain imagination. Come on, get it out of your spirit. Get it out of your heart. Get it out of your mind. Get it out. Come on. Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are holy, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. I dare you right now. Somebody ought to shout. Somebody ought to go ahead and shout, I'm going in to the promised land. I'm going in to the promised land. Come on, I'm going in. I'm going in. Come on, somebody give him a praise. Get a hold of this right now in your spirit. The way they perceived their situation had a profound effect on the way they saw themselves. God does not prepare a promise and then find somebody who will fit the promise. Every promise and blessing of God has a name on it. So if God saw your promise, that means he saw you walking in it. He saw you blessed enough. He saw you strong enough. He saw you able enough. God would not put your name on something that you could not possess. And so I need somebody right now to lift your hands and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. God, show me who I am. God, show me that I'm a victorious person. Show me that I'm a champion.
Faith over fear.
Go, go, go. Pray until your hand is on it. Pray until it's in your spirit. Pray until your mind is regulated. Come on, come on.
Faith over fear.
Yes. Listen, the Holy Ghost is doing something in this building right now. Don't you dare get a casual Tuesday night mentality right now and run over the top of what God's doing in this altar call, because something's about to shift in somebody's life in this place tonight. I said something's about to shift in somebody's life in this building tonight. The voice an entire nation stood on the bank of promise, and the voice of just 10 unbelievers Hear me. The voice of just 10 unbelievers was enough potency of negativism to dilute the faith of an entire nation. Only 10. The whole nation had to decide, are we going to believe the 10 or the 2? And the voice of just 10 negative people was enough to negate the faith of an entire nation. And an entire generation died in the wilderness because they would not believe. That tells you what's on the line for your faith tonight. Hello? That ought to tell you tonight how touchy and how important it is, the voices that you allow to influence your life. If 10 people and their influence can negate the faith of an entire nation, what can just one voice of negativity that you entertain in your life do to your destiny and your promise? A whole generation died. You know what I thought of? I would have hated to have been the last person alive from that old generation. Because you got a whole new generation now. That the whole reason they had to wait was because of the mentality of an old generation. And I promise you, they started counting them down. 12 of them left. 10 of them left. Only 3 people alive from the... I would have hated to have been the last person alive from that old generation. Can you imagine them laying on their deathbed with the whole nation standing around them saying, I wish you'd hurry up and die. We got a promise that's waiting on us. And you're the only thing standing between us and our promise. I think if I would have been there, I would have looked both ways. And if nobody was looking, I probably would have put my foot on somebody's neck. Why don't I help you a little bit here? This is what I feel in the Holy Ghost. Some of you have the chance tonight to put your foot on the neck of unbelief. If you'll get the right perspective, some of you have the opportunity tonight to put your foot on the neck of unbelief and say, tonight's the last night. You're gonna die tonight. I'm walking through the promise. I'm not a grasshopper. I'm a child of promise. I'm a child of miracles. Somebody right now ought to just get in the Holy Ghost and start pressing. Somebody ought to get in the Holy Ghost right now. Come on. Come on. Come on. I'm moving forward. I'm moving forward. Declare the vision of God. Faith over fear.
Faith over fear. I got the victory set. You got the victory set.
God's able.
Faith over fear.
God is able.
I got the victory set. You got the victory set.
Come on, come on, come on, come on.
Faith over fear.
It's time to walk in it. It's time to walk in it.
Faith over fear.
big shout of praise in this house. Come on, shout like you got faith in your spirit. Shout like you're about to walk into your promise. Shout like you're believing God for the impossible. I'm telling somebody, God's prophecy over this house is not just a collective prophecy. It's a prophecy that's for you as an individual. So whatever God says about this house, God's saying it about you. I just need 10 people to grab a hold of that right now. It's the year of the open door. Tell your neighbor, it's a great door. How many of you remember the etymology? Tell your neighbor, it's a mega door. Tell him, oh yeah, and by the way, it's an effectual door. Tell him, translation, it's a powerful door. It's a mega powerful door. That's not just a word for this house, that's a word for you tonight. Listen, I was unable to be here Sunday. I was preaching out of state, but I'll tell you what I felt in the Holy Ghost concerning the vision of this house. Remember, we're not just a house of vision, but we're a church of mission. Vision is seeing it. Mission is doing it. Sunday mornings, this place is packed. It's packed. A few Sundays ago, I watched the ushers. They couldn't hardly find any place for a family of five or six walked in. They couldn't even find a place for them to sit together anywhere in the floor. How many of you can see beyond where we're at right now to what God is doing? This facility isn't big enough. And there ain't no grasshoppers running around saying, oh, ha, it's too big, it's too hard. No, that's not how we do it. If God let us see it, that means God will empower us to do it. Looking beyond where we're standing right now over the next couple of years, I believe God is positioning us for the next paradigm of what he's doing in this house. And I feel like God dropped something in my spirit. You understand this. I've preached it here. For vision, there has to be provision. We always quote the scripture, without a vision, the people perish. But we understand without the people, the vision will perish. We're the miracle. We're the conduit that God uses to provision the vision. And I don't know what the economy's going to look like 2 years from now. I don't know what the real estate market, I don't know what none of those things look like. We don't, you're exactly right. It doesn't matter. I know what the church is going to look like. I know what kind of promises the church has. But we have to have hand and eye coordination. We have to line everything up in the world of the finite. We have to line it up with the world of the infinite. We have to let vision, the shadow of vision, cast itself onto the earth as a pattern and say, all right, God, as it is in heaven, let it be on the earth. And so, whatever that thing is, whatever's coming around the corner, whatever that next dimensional step is, it's for one purpose. It is to make provision for the revival and the harvest that God is bringing this house. And I feel like God dropped a number in my mind. I was thinking over the next couple of years, God, what can we do? And I felt like God said, you, the Rock Church, needs to bring $1 million to the table over the next 2 years. Grasshoppers or people of faith tonight? That means that every one of us has to have hand and eye coordination. That means we have to be all in. That means every young person needs a revelation of God using you financially. That means every young adult that's single, it's time for you to quit acting like a grasshopper. Come on, is this all right? You're not in a church full of grasshoppers. If you're a young single adult and you're working a job and you're not faithful and you're giving and giving sacrificially, it's time to get on board. Time to get on track. You don't want to be that generation that God says, they ain't going to see this thing. That means that every young couple in this building, it's time to line up hand and eye coordination with the vision of God. God's looking for conduits of blessing. I'll tell you what, God's looking for some young couples that he can trust with millions of dollars. I thought I'd have more than one. God's looking for some families that he can trust with multiple millions of dollars. So when God turns the spigot on, it doesn't get clogged at your front door. But you understand that you're just a conduit for God to flow through. Come on, who am I talking to? If God can get it through you, God will bring it to you. I don't know what any of it looks like 2 years from now, but I feel like this church needs to be able to stand up and say, we've got $1 million of faith in our hands to make whatever move we've got to make. Now listen, to some of us, $1 million is a lot of money. Listen, everything is scalable to who you are and where you're at. Anybody that knows anything about commercial real estate understands that $1 million is nothing. And it's really nothing when you compare it to how big the dream and the vision of God is for this house. Whenever we get ready, whenever God says move, here it is. Whenever God shows it to us and says step through, here's the door, here's the situation. I want to be able to step to the plate and say, we've been waiting for this moment right here. We're not unprepared. We didn't let this catch us by surprise. We came ready. Listen, and that $1 million doesn't just represent money. I'm going to tell you what it means. It means there's a people who took dominion in the dimension of finances. That's what it represents. It represents a group of people that took dominion and have a revelation of the blessing of God. You know what God was telling them? I've got a land of promise that flows with milk and honey, houses you didn't build, vineyards you didn't plant. If you can grab it, you can have it. I feel like that's where we're going to be in just a little bit of time. God's going to say, if you prepared, if you could walk through the door, it's yours. How many of you ready to move in faith with me? And all of this is a byproduct of harvest and revival. Don't get it backwards. We're not saving money and buying buildings just to have big buildings and big churches. This is a facilitation of end time revival. So we're not getting our eye off the ball. We're going to keep the main thing the main thing. And while we are seeing unprecedented harvest and revival, we're preparing with the vision of God for what he's doing in the future. Amen. One more time, I want us to give God a great big praise before we leave this house. Come on, I want us to give God a great big praise before we leave this place tonight. Come on, grasshoppers don't eat grapes.
It's time to stop jumping around in the grass, and it's time to put your hands on the promise of God. It's time to let your vision get a hold. It's time to line up your hands with your eyes. Come on, in the name of Jesus, we declare it tonight. Every promise, every miracle, every blessing, God, that you said belongs to us, we take it in Jesus' name. We're walking in it in Jesus' name. God bless you tonight. We'll see you Thursday night in prayer. Let the call-ins know how excited we are to have them in the house of the Lord.
Take all the peace.